Good evening, all of you. So we'll discuss few problems on the rolling motion, rolling applications, then instantaneous axis of rotation. So these two ideas is what let me try to finish off in today's evening class. So as morning we have discussed the rolling on inclined plane. So one problem I'm just picking up. Okay, read the question now. A spinning cylinder with angle of omega naught of mass m and radius r is lowered on a rough inclined plane of angle 30 with horizontal and mu equal to 1 by 3. Angle of inclination is 30 degrees. Mu of that inclined plane is 30 degrees. This is the mu. Find the total time taken by the cylinder to reach the bottom of the incline. Now it is given angle, it is not released from rest, it is given an angular velocity. Please try to understand, it is given an angular velocity. So when it is given angular velocity, so in what direction the friction should act up the incline, sir, on what basis? Because it's there is a slipping is there, no? In fact, there is a slipping is there. So friction will act up the incline. Then there's a radius r. Sorry, one more thing. Let me show all the forces. Mg sin theta, mg cos theta, and this is the normal contact. In fact, there's a slipping is there. So because of that, the friction will act here. Okay, let's come for, he has given mu equal to 1 by root 3. Let's calculate all. So what is Fk equal to? What is n equal to? Mg cos theta. Perpendicular to inclined plane, n minus mg cos theta equals 0. So what is Fk is equal to? Mu n. It's not a rolling friction. Kinetic friction. Not a rolling friction. But sir, you only said rolling friction. Look at the condition. Given angular velocity and released. So mu k, this will be mu mg cos theta. So let's calculate this value of this one. This is mu equal to how much? 1 by root 3 mg cos theta, cos 30, root 3 by 2. How much we are getting? Mg by 2. How much of mg sin theta? So what is this? This should be equal to. This should also mg by 2. So in fact, what's happening is, Fk minus mg sin theta equal to 0 along the incliner. So what happened to net force on this spinning cylinder along the incline will be 0, that one along the incline. So therefore what happened, that one no acceleration along the incline, then only because of friction acting there will be an anti-torque, angular acceleration will act here. Alpha O will write it. How to calculate that torque? Fk into R should be equal to I O alpha O. Fk is what? Mu mg cos theta into R. I think already we know Fk value. If you want to substitute. So this shall be called retardation. Why retardation? Because how do the kinetic friction, it will set up a torque. This is R bar, this is Fk. It will set up anti-torque, no? And angular velocity is given is clockwise. The torque is set up anti-clockwise. So why not torque due to weight? It will intersect axis of rotation. About O, the torque is set up by only kinetic friction. About O. This where we are defining about O. Okay, let's calculate this one. So this everything should be mg. So what is the value of Fk? Fk equal to mg by 2, I'll write it. So again, y2. So r get cancelled. So what is alpha naught is equal to? G by r. Can we calculate now the time taken for the angular velocity to become 0? 0 equal to omega naught plus alpha naught T1. So what is T1? T1 is equal to so what you should comment this T1 time taken for the cylinder only to spin. It will not slide, it will be there only. Time taken for the cylinder to spin. It will not slide here. Time taken by cylinder to spin. Without sliding along incline. I think this comment is very important. And now once after this time, this is t equal to zero. This t equal to zero. So what will happen to this particular? So once omega becomes zero, then what will happen? Then once omega becomes zero, it starts sliding. No, when it starts sliding, so what is the time taken by it to reach the bottom of incline? It will reach the bottom of incline with a velocity v and omega, and this is the time t equal to t1, and to slide, what will happen? It will take a time to t2. So how to ensure that it will have pure, no slipping or pure rolling occurs when it's sliding down the incline? Any condition? Because there is a slipping occurs between point P of the disc of the cylinder and the incline plane. So therefore kinetic friction. So it will only rotate there. It will not slide because the net force along the incline is zero. Okay, now after this, once angular velocity has become zero, then what happens? Mg sin theta force will act. Then here now rolling friction will act here. Now rolling friction will act. Then center of mass will accelerate, call A naught. Then this friction will set up a torque, alpha naught. So some other better will call only alpha, that one here. And this is a strictly rolling friction. And now, sir, how do you can say that no slipping occurs? What is the guarantee? Tell me what I should do, whose help I should take? And what is the minimum value of mu for no slipping to occur for a solid cylinder? Solid cylinder or disc, both are same. Can you recollect morning we have discussed what should be the minimum value of mu for no slipping to occur? That's what, see, like, if you remember some data, it'll be much more useful for you. What should be the minimum value of mu? Minimum value of mu required for no slipping is how much? Tan theta by 3. Morning we have discussed, no? Can you hear me? Shall I continue?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Power gone. With mobile, we'll manage things. Anybody morning? Shall we say minimum value of mu? Mu minimum. Morning, we derived. No. Anybody, please check. Anybody, I think I won't. Tan theta by 3. Okay, fine. Yeah. So what is the minimum value of mu? Tan theta by 3. Okay, what is the mu given? Let's check what is mu given. 1 by root 3. Okay, will it satisfy? So let me substitute here. Tan 30. Please do understand, it's a very good problem. Tan 30, value of tan 30, 1 by root 3. The mu of the inclined plane is 1 by root 3. But minimum value of mu needed for no slipping, how much? 1 by 3 root 3. So the mu is greater than mu minimum or less than mu minimum? Is in fact greater than mu minimum. This is very important. Please try to understand the concept which I am trying to reflect here. So therefore, what happens? If the mu of inclined plane greater than mu minimum, what happens? Slipping will occur or pure rolling will occur. What will occur? If mu of inclined plane less than mu minimum, then slipping will occur. Whatever you do it. If the mu of inclined plane is greater than mu minimum, then what happens? Pure rolling will occur. So therefore here, pure rolling takes place. Got the idea? How to utilize this morning, what we discussed, how to use that concept is this one. This is very important. So in every numerical, please do. I think it's all about in exam, you can't derive this. Are you getting? No, I asked you to remember something. What should be the minimum value of mu for a ring, for a disc? Ring or hollow cylinder, both are same. Disc, solid cylinder, both are same. Solid sphere, hollow sphere. That particular equation you remember. In exams, directly you can start. Otherwise, what happens, you should search, you should derive this, then you should enter problem. It'll become very lengthy. Getting some? So I'm trying to give you some help here. You should remember all this data. Okay, now let's come. So pure rolling will occur. So what is the time taken? So can we calculate expression for acceleration? So what are the formulas? Mg sine theta. Minus F equal to Ma. Then F into R is equal to Mr square by 2 into alpha for pure rolling. So now you can write pure rolling on what basis? Yes, the mu is greater than mu in pure rolling. Solving this, R alpha, I'll write it. This will be F equal to Ma by 2. R alpha, I'll substitute here. Then R also, I'll cancel out. Then I'll get F. This value of F, I'll substitute there. Mg sine theta minus Ma by 2 equal to Ma. So what is A is equal to 2g sine theta by 3. Now what is the height of the inclined plane given? H. You try to, 3r it is given. So what can be the distance? What can be this distance? So yes. What is the overall distance it has to slide? From year to year, what is the time taken? And I think I'm helping with almost all what actually going on here. I know how to calculate this t2. For that we need x, and for that what is given? This height is 3r given, and we know this theta. So sine theta is equal to 3r by x. So x equal to 3r by sine theta. Theta is how much? 30 degrees. So therefore this will be 3r 1 by 2 6r. Then what is the time taken? We know acceleration. We know the distance. So x is equal to a t2 square by 2. So 6r 2g sine theta by 3 t2 square by 2. So all this, you'll get the value of t2. Then what is the total time taken by it? T1 plus t2. By the time it reaches here, t1 is the time taken. What is the t2 you should call? What is t2? Time taken to roll down the incline. What is the T1? Time taken for they to spin there only. It will first only spin, then after. So I think two frictions are there. There's a really, really very good problem telling this one. First, it will only spin. Angular velocity decreases. First, it will be like this. Then, able to understand the problem? First, it will only have spin, means it will only rotate there. Why can't slide down? Because Fk equal to mg sin theta. So it'll be like this. Then. So two times are there, no? T1 and T2. Please do. These are some very basic fundamental problems which you should, with respect to inclined plane.
Sir, the mu what you gave, sir, is it the static frictions mu, sir?
Which one, ma'am?
1/3.
1/3. Yes, it is a mu, static friction only.
So then, I mean, static and kinetic friction are balancing each other, right?
Here, mu, see, like when I
Sorry,
don't.
static and mg sine theta, sorry.
The problem here is like the mu, what happened when I don't mention anything? I think mu is equal to mu k. Finish over long back, we outside. No. Why you are troubling yourself with unnecessary thoughts?
Sorry, sir. Yes, sir. Understood.
Nothing to do that one. Just say, if I write mu s or mu k, then we could have debated. I didn't mention anything. Finish over. So mu s equal to mu k. Depend upon the condition. If the slide body sliding, still you can write same thing. If body is at rest, then static friction will not come mu, no. Static friction should be equal to mg sin theta. Here, the kinetic friction is becoming equal to mg sin theta. I should not call this a static. I think this is a, I'll be killing the total friction chapter if I call this static. Because slipping occurs, it's a kinetic. Okay, after this, okay, now we'll go back to a few more. There's a rigid body. I'll apply force F on the rigid body. So let this be a disc. And let this be a plank, and let this be rough. Then what is the maximum force for which no slipping occurs, or what is the minimum force for which slipping occurs? Either way, find maximum value of F for which no slipping occurs between the disc and the plank. Morning, we applied force where? I think morning we applied force F. Okay, that I think on the plank we applied it. Anybody, can you tell morning what we did? I think again, instead of repeating same problem, I'll check once. Morning we all did four. We have done this one. Okay, that one. I'll do one thing. Yeah. Let me apply force on the plank. Now, what is the maximum value of force for which no slipping occurs? I'll give the question. Find the okay, proceed in the similar way. Okay, now, yeah, let's come to the. What are the forces that will be acting? How the friction should act here? The friction will oppose relative motion. F will acting here. This frictional force will act on the rigid body like this. This friction force, what it does, it will accelerate center of mass and it will set up torque. Sir, how it is possible? Yes, it can happen here. And let the acceleration of this be A2. And we took two points, no? P1, P2. For no slipping, acceleration of P1 should be equal to P2. That will come later on. So let's write the equations of motion. On the plank, F minus small f equal to M2 A2. On the rolling rigid body, F should be equal to M1 A1 because only friction is what will accelerate the center of mass. Then at the same time friction will set up an anti-torque. You see, like this is R bar, this is F. So how the torque will be anti-clockwise. torque will be anti-clockwise. So this should become F into R is equal to IC into alpha 1. Okay, this is about the equation 1, equation 2, equation 3. How many unknowns are there? 4 unknowns are there, no? I need one more equation. So what is the basic equation I write? For no slipping. And tell me, for no slipping, what shall I write? Acceleration of point P1 equal to acceleration of point P2. It's a very generalized, don't bother anything big. So, but sir, earlier you wrote acceleration for pure rolling. Yes, now for pure rolling, the platform is accelerating. So therefore, acceleration of lowest point of the rigid body should be equal to acceleration of Planck. This is a basic condition. So don't write for pure rolling A1 equal to R alpha 1. This is a condition for no slipping. What is acceleration of point P1? Due to transitive motion, A1. Due to tangential acceleration, R alpha 1. What is acceleration of the Planck? A2. Now substitute A1, F by M1. R alpha 1, 2F by M1. What is A2? Capital F minus small f by M2. Solving for capital F in terms of small f, we'll get the required answer. I think of all this, this is the central idea of the problem. No slipping. Yeah, no slipping means it then. When, but sir, like earlier, you wrote like this. Here you just wrote, because what is acceleration of point P1? P2. The P2 is a ground, no? Ground will move. Ground will never move, no? So here also the idea is same. What is that one? For no slipping or pure rolling, this is a thing. This is what? A1 minus R alpha 1. What is acceleration of the ground? Zero. That's why it has become A1 equal to R alpha 1. Getting the idea? See, like, I don't think so. This what a student should have thought like this. Sir, what do you mean by no slipping? The no slipping means this is what? If the ground also accelerates, then the conditions will come like this. Put the acceleration of the ground, then you discuss the problem. Okay, now let's solve for this one here. So let me bring all F terms on one side. This will be, I think, 4F by F1 is equal to F by M2. Sorry. This will be 3F by M1 plus F by M2 is equal to F by M2. So if I solve for F, it should be 3M2 by M1 plus M1 into the rolling friction. Now, I'll keep on increase applied force. I'll keep on increase applied force. Rolling friction also will increase. So, but it should be static friction. No, it's a rolling friction. The rolling friction also acting here between the disc and the plank will increase. Then what is the maximum permitted value of rolling friction? Equal to limiting friction. Sir, this is, we are getting confused. You are saying the friction varies as that of applied force. It was similar to static. At the same time, again saying it's a rolling friction, and again you are writing mu s mg. Yes. What is the idea? What is the maximum permitted value of rolling friction is equal to limiting friction, but it is not a static friction. It's a rolling friction only. Again and again, I'm repeating that one. So I'll keep on increase applied force. So what is the maximum permitted value of mu s m1 g? So if I apply force less than this, no slipping occurs. If I apply force greater than this value, then between them slipping occurs, then you cannot write this equation. That's all. You can solve the problem, but you cannot write. Then you can't write A1 equal to R alpha 1 then also. They may ask you problem with slipping also. Then no problem. Just you call A1, then you cannot write this equation. That's all. These are all, as usual, you can define it. See, to trouble you in exams, what they do, they give intentionally this force greater than F max. They'll ask you to find out the acceleration of the center of the disc. center of mass of the disk. I think once you know F, can you calculate A2? Oh, this is the plus form. Yeah. Okay, I think fine. Yeah. No, intentionally I'll apply force which is greater than F max. Then in that case, what will happen? What is the friction will act? Rolling friction or kinetic friction? It will be kinetic friction. I think problem is very simple. No, you know this Fk. Can you get A1? Yes. Problem solved. So you should ready for all the things in books open. They are just discussed only for no slipping. Intentionally, I'll ask you problem with the slipping. So carry on, no problem. So I'll write the data like this. F less than F max. Friction will be rolling. If F greater than F max, the friction acting will be kinetic. Are you getting the idea? And for rolling friction, you can't write mu s mg. No. Kinetic friction, yes, you can write it. What is the kinetic friction now? This should be equal to Fk, I'll write it. The friction will be kinetic. Then is equal to how much it is? Mu mng. If they give mu k or anything, you substitute that. Okay, no, just have idea. It's a very, very good problem. Just as students, what happened, are made to learn things here. I'll scroll down. Now we'll take the next condition. And now in the same problem, if it is A, is there any rule that I can apply force like this also, no? How to predict the direction of friction here now? So it all depends upon the rigid body. Can you remember now? So I think some very morning we have discussed. There is some threshold point will be there, no? I call that as A. For a disc, what is the threshold point? R by 2. For a ring, capital R. For a sphere, 2R by 5. If you apply force above threshold point, the friction will act in the direction of applied force, rolling friction. If you apply force below the threshold point, then what will happen to the friction? The friction will act opposite to applied force. So whether the plank will move or not will determine where you applied force. Now if I say this is a disc, let me call this a disc. IC is equal to first case. IC is equal to MR square. So MR square by 2. And I'll put smaller equal to R by 2. Now tell me what happens here. What conditions will prevail here? The plank will be at rest. Sir, what is this? Why friction will not act? Yes, friction will not act. Then acceleration of center of mass A1. This is alpha 1. That's all. The plank will be attached. Plank will not move. Why friction will not act? I think you know. If you apply the force exactly at the threshold point here, where R by 2, no friction will act here. So then plank will not move. No friction acts, then plank will not move. No, same thing. Second case. I'm discussing for disk. It is a disk, no? MR square by 2. We know moment of inertia. Second case, let this be equal to 2R by 3. Where is the point of application of force now? It has come. It's going to be the above threshold point, no? Now what you can say? In what direction the friction should act here? Center of mass will accelerate. There'll be torque. Friction, what action? Friction will act forward. and the Planck friction on the Planck will be there. In what direction the Planck will move? In this direction. Then condition for no slipping, A2 should be equal to R alpha 1 minus A1. Things are reverse. And what is the condition for no slipping here? A1 equal to R alpha 1. So why Planck will move? Because the friction on the disc will act towards right. And the Planck on the Planck will be towards left. I think the things are little bit very systematic here. Already we have discussed in the morning. Now similarly, if I bring the force R by 4. What do you mean by R by 4? Where it is? Below the threshold point. Hmm? No. In what direction? I'm just showing for a disk. Then with that, you manage other things. If any other rigid body, you should manage it. Okay, this is rough. Definitely, can you say in what direction the friction? The friction will hang backward. The reason for that, R by 4 is less than R by 2. The point of application of force is less than below the threshold point. So the friction here will act backward. And the friction on the Planck will be like this. Center of mass will accelerate. And this is alpha 1. Condition for no slipping, A1 minus R alpha 1 should be equal to E2. So I think the where you apply force matters a lot. In the second case, the force applied is where above the threshold point. Because for a disc, what is the threshold point? R by 2, capital R by 2. What is the radius of the disc? The radius of the disc is capital R. Try to understand. This is what happened. Threshold point is R by 2. Where is the point of application? 2 R by 3. Above the threshold point. No? If you apply force above the threshold point, in what direction rolling friction will act? The rolling friction will act in the direction of applied force. Morning, what we discussed. So then friction acts, then how alpha 1 should be? Then I'm considering that this applied force will set up a torque. Alpha 1, I'm taking this one. Sir, I'll solve it. If I get alpha 1 negative, then change the direction. But alpha 1 will be clockwise only. Take it for granted. Trust your teacher. The friction will like, the friction on the Planck will be like this. Then acceleration of Planck will be like this. Then condition for no slipping. Acceleration of the Planck should be equal to R alpha 1 minus A1. Either way, you can write it. So I think you have to be very careful. No, you can't just take blindly and go right in any direction you want friction. You should take care about that conditions. Morning, what I discussed, that is very, very important. Friction, what direction will act here? Now, till now, okay, let's do one thing. I'm going to place a cylinder on cylinder. Let me place a Planck. Till now, what happened? We discussed the problems where the rigid body was on some Planck. So now let the Planck be there on the rigid body. So let this be solid cylinder and let this be a Planck. Now I'm going to push the Planck with a forceps. Sir, we are not understanding what you're drawing. Just very simple. You take notebook and you take pencil. The pencil is a solid cylinder. Then keep notebook on the pencil and start pushing the notebook. The pencil also starts rolling. you can try. See, it's a very beautiful. I'm telling this one. Mechanics. Once you start realize it practically, you know, you feel you are studying something very simple things. Lack of practical knowledge only, you feel mechanics very, very difficult. Or any cylindrical object in your home. Take notebook or some any writing pad, what all you have, some sort of little bit like rigid, put it, you start pushing it, push the Planck. Then open the cylinder also starts rolling. Now we have to discuss like what is the acceleration of all this one. Planck of the Planck of mass m is pushed horizontally by a force, by external force F. Find the acceleration of cylinder. Okay, this is also rough. Friction is sufficient for pure rolling. Friction is, or no slipping occurs at all surface. Better right. No slipping occurs at all surfaces. Fine. Okay, no. Please do realize. As a teacher, I'm requesting with a folded answer. See, you become good engineer, I'll get happiness, that's all. But really, when you become good engineer, no, I'll really feel very, very happy. I'm telling this one alone. I'm just here to make difference in your thinking ability, that's all. I want thinking brain. Discipline, all these are secondary. The primary is what? Engineer should have a thinking brain. The thinking brain will come only by observation. So all this rotation mechanics. See, in class, if it were physical class, I've shown in camera, I'm unable to show it. Because if I start showing physical things, no, 1 hour, one problem we'll discuss. In classroom, what happened? Very easy. On table, I'll just keep, and within 2 minutes, I'll show it, finish over. We could have enjoyed a lot in this physical classroom. No, okay, anyway, we'll compromise here. So I just suggest you take any cylindrical object, shampoo bottle or anything that one, which is cylindrical in shape. Keep some plate, anything, a plate, a notebook or cardboard or something, or you have any wooden plank or something that one. Keep it on the, start pushing this. Sir, what do you mean by pushing? All of you know how to push somebody like that. You push this, it will start rolling. So that we are discussing. Okay, no. The moment you start pushing, how the friction here will act. The friction here will act in this direction. Sir, how you can see? I think this is a very basic idea, no? So the moment you push this plank, the cylinder will oppose, because initially they were at rest. The friction will act on the plank towards left. Action, reaction, equal and opposite force will always occur in pair. The friction on the cylinder will act towards right. Okay, now let's the beauty of this, already you know that one. Where this will become like external force on the cylinder. Where it is applied? Above threshold point, where the threshold point will come for cylinder, R by 2, above center of mass. But where the F1 is acting, above threshold point, I'll just put threshold point, some dot, blue color. What is the blue color? Threshold point. Look at now, where the friction is acting, above the threshold point. So tell me how the friction at the bottom from the ground should act. So it should act in what direction? In the direction of applied force. The F1 will become applied force. Both F1, F2 are rolling friction. I'm making things clear. Both but sir, F1 is something, as both F1 F2 are rolling friction. Now what is the acceleration of Planck? Call A1. Acceleration of A2, then it will have, so let me take the points P1, P2, P3. For no slipping occurs at all surface. AP1 is equal to AP2. What is the acceleration of the Planck? A1. What is the acceleration of highest point of the cylinder? A2 plus R alpha 2. Agreed? Okay, now similarly, AP3 should be equal to 0. Or you do one thing, write it. Think it. Ground will move. If you push that plate and cylinder, then your like a floor in the house will start moving. No, this ground will be at rest. No. So what is the acceleration of ground? Should be 0. Then what is AP3? A2 minus R alpha 2. Okay, now write all the possible equations. F minus small f1 equal to MA1 on the Planck. Then on the cylinder, F1 plus F2, both will act towards right, M2, E2. Any other equations can we write? Torque equation, net torque, F1 into R, F2 into R should be equal to. Okay, no need to solve, just learn. So you can calculate this rolling friction, all other things, all the unknown, you can calculate here. So you substitute them in these equations and solve it, you'll get all the unknown things.
Sir, solid cylinder, 2/5 mr square, moment of inertia.
Mr square by 2, my dear. Solid sphere is 2/5 mr square, okay?
Okay, sir.
So I think now any number of rigid bodies, can you do like this? Yes. What is there in that one? We can manage. Rigid body on a plank, plank on a rigid body. We can manage in this way. I'll scroll down. Anybody taking, just take this print out here. We'll take the next condition. If this is the let me take, this is the ring, or let me take this cone. Radius r, the mass of this be m1, let this be m2, and this is rough. I'll just give only linear velocity v0 and release. Planck is at rest. This is rough. A disk of mass m1 is given linear velocity v0 and released on Planck of mass m2. Find the time at which no slipping occurs. Find the time at which no slipping occurs, or slipping ceases, or pure rolling occurs, is telling. Okay, now go back. First problem. We release this particular disc on the ground. No, instead of ground, I am releasing it on a plank. And the surface between the plank and the disc is rough, and between the plank and the ground, it is smooth. After what time it will attain pure rolling? Find the time at which the disc attains pure rolling, or no slipping occurs. But initially slipping will be there. Why? Why initially slipping? Look at the velocity of point P. Will be velocity of center of mass only. So there will be V0. Planck is at rest. So therefore, forward slipping occurs. So how the friction should act here? The friction will act, in fact, backward. So the initial diagram, let me keep it. Okay, I'll start discussing for this diagram. Now, in what direction friction will act, you know? This is on the disc. Why backward? I think it's quite clear, no? Opposite to velocity of center. Then the friction on the plank will act here. I'll show it here. Some books they have shown, it's left to you. So this friction, what it does, it will produce retardation. And at the same time, it'll set up a torque. This friction accelerating will make it to accelerate. Tell me what will what will happen with this? After some time, where do the plank you can see now? Where do this plank, and what will happen to the disc? After some time, once it attains pure rolling, so after some time the disc, what happened, will come somewhere here. Oh, yeah. And they will start moving with a constant angular velocity. No slipping occurs afterwards, and the no friction will act here. This is what t equal to zero. This is a time. How to calculate this time? what is A1? Can you tell what is the retardation? What is this friction, rolling or kinetic friction? I want you to answer. This is our best way of again trying to get the clarity about the friction. It's a kinetic friction, no? Is it like sliding friction? What is this? It's a sliding, or better, right, kinetic friction. And what is the kinetic friction? Mu k mg. So what is the coefficient of friction? It is mu. So therefore, what is F is equal to? In fact, F is equal to mu mng. Sir, it must be a rolling, sir. We are discussing rotation mechanics. Any friction acts rolling. Whose side like that? Nothing, no. It all depends on the condition here. Okay, now I think very easy. So what is the retardation A1? A1 equal to F by M1, which is equal to mu g. Then it will set up a torque. F into R is equal to M1 R square by 2 into alpha 1. So what is F is equal to? M1 R alpha 1 by 2. And what is in turn F? Mu MNG. So what is alpha 1? 2 mu G by R. Angular acceleration. And what is A2 is equal to? I think the second and third diagram are needed, no? Mm-hmm. What is A2 should be equal to? F by M2. Okay, we got all the values. For no slipping, tell me what you can write. For no slipping. Velocity of this point should be equal to velocity of this point. For no slipping, what is velocity of point P1? V1 minus R omega. What is the velocity of point P2? VP2. How to calculate V1? How to calculate V1? We don't know all these things, no? How to calculate V1? V1, shall I write A1 V0 minus V1 equal to, from this retardation, V0 plus A1, and I substitute A1T. Then what about R omega 1? R omega 1, what you can write? Alpha 1 into T. What about VP2? A2 into T. Substitute A1, A2, all this, solve it, you'll get expression for time. The time at which the slipping stops. No friction will act here. As a rolling friction should act because it is having pure rolling. No. Why? I think it's a velocity pure rolling problem, not accelerated pure rolling problem. Able to understand? It's a velocity pure rolling problem, not accelerated pure rolling problem. For t less than this t, for time less than this t, slipping occurs. Afterwards, no slipping occurs. No idea of your rolling friction. Why rolling friction will come? When the rolling friction will come, only when you apply external force, rolling friction will come into picture. Substitute all these equations. A1 equal to minus mu gt, V0 minus mu gt. What is alpha? Alpha R1, we can write it as 2 mu gt. What is A2? A2 should be equal to mu M1 g by. Solving this, we'll get expression for time. Okay, no? So I'll go for instantaneous axis of rotation. Tomorrow we'll discuss some other problems related to this. Now, can you remember instantaneous axis of rotation? I used to tell what do you mean instant axis for a body having pure rolling motion? there are two ways of studying this problem. And what are the two ways? You can describe the motion with respect to ground. Or you can also describe this entire motion is equivalent to once I'll make you to recollect, then we'll discuss the numericals here. So this is a point P, no? Then if you stand here, then what you see that all points are rotating with same angular velocity omega. Then what is the velocity of any point? I want velocity of this point. What I should do? I'm going to draw, then I'll get velocity V1. I want velocity of this point. What shall I do? I'm going to draw a line perpendicular, I'll get V2. So what is this? With what angular velocity? Pure rolling. It's a pure rolling. The body is having pure rolling. When pure rolling only, this will come. If you stand on the ground, you see all points are rotating about center of mass and center of mass moving. With angular velocity omega, they're rotating center of mass. If you come and stand here, exactly here, and what is this P now? Instantaneous center. Don't call here instantaneous center. What is the velocity of point P? You're going to write, and for pure rolling, that's all. You say, what is the velocity of point P? This person, what he says? Velocity of point P at that instant is zero. Now, instead of standing there, you better come at point where velocity is zero. At that instant, you stand at a point where velocity of the lowest point is zero. Then what will happen? The whole bodies will appear as if rotating about point P. With the same angular velocity, with what omega they're rotating about, see, with the same. This point P is called as now instantaneous center. And an axis passing through instantaneous center is called as instantaneous axis of rotation. And in short, we'll call it as IAOR. What is the advantage of this? Tell me, like, which particular motion you find very difficult to define? This one, no, it's like a pure circular motion. What about here? Both translative, rotative motion. So here, what happened? About P, only rotative motion. About G, both rotatory. Yes, somebody. About P, both rotatory and translator. Are you getting the core idea? This is entire the core idea of this one. G means above the ground. Here, somewhere is standing here. P is instant center. Tell me, like, which one you can. I think I really like this one. This is easy. So therefore, I'll give priority for this. Got the idea? No. And we also derived LGZ is equal to LPZ. We also found out the kinetic energy, everything. So either you study the motion of the object either being on the ground or at point P, everything is same. So therefore, this will be preferred here. So how to calculate the velocity of any point? So what we do, we'll locate instantaneous center of a system, and all points are rotating about instant center, as it's a pure circular motion problem, and we'll work out the numerical. This is the idea of the problems here. Let it be whatever the type of rigid body. So let me take the first situation.
About both G and P, sir, only angular momentum is same, sir, or?
Finish for both, no? Kinetic energy. You measure either standing at P or G, it will be same.
Okay, sir.
And now there are we can't show it. Look at no. So this is a rigid body. We'll keep it one. And this is the radius of it. Center of mass it is. This is having velocity, say 2v, or say like a 3v, and this is having a velocity v. I want the velocity of a point and this rigid body. It's a cylinder. Let me take a cylinder. And what is this? This upper belt. This is a lower belt. I want the velocity of point P, velocity of center of mass, and the total kinetic energy of the cylinder. Find VP, VC, and kinetic energy of cylinder. Where it is rolling between the upper and lower belts. Where do we see? I think there's a practical diagram will be like this. I think in our book they have shown nowhere such application is there. Usually this will be gears, it will happen. This will be lower gear and this will be upper, this will be lower gear. This is what actually happens here. By moving these belts, so what I can do, I can make that particular gear to rotate. This is what actually the engineering applications will take place like this. But I don't know why our books have shown like this. This is of no use, nowhere we use the left-hand diagram. This is the correct diagram. In advanced exam, they may trouble you. Don't get confused here. So when this belt moves, what will happen? This will be in contact. No, the teeth will be such that it will make this to rotate. So I'm asking now, what is the velocity of this point? Able to understand? No, it's, I think, very simplified way of thinking. No. What is the velocity of this point? What is velocity speed of this teeth at this instant? What is velocity and what is the total kinetic energy of this? This will appear like a cylinder. Don't bother that deformation at the teeth. Still, you can treat like a cylinder. Now, let's get into the problem. So, what method you apply? But sir, we don't know what is the angular velocity. So, how do it move? It will roll. So, what is the motion of this gear? It will be rotating and also moving forward. So what will happen to this gear? Both translational and rotation. What about this? Only translational motion. This cannot rotate, no belt. So what happened to the cylinder? It are both rotatory as well as translatory motion. But sir, you have not given angular velocity. How is possible? Yes, we can find out everything. We can even find out the angular velocity also. Sir, about what point it is rotating? If you stand on the ground, it will rotate about center of mass. If you stand at ancient center, with the same angular velocity, is going to rotate. Okay, how to calculate ancient center? So I'm going to circular motion. Already we have discussed this in circular motion. You might have not noticed. So if a rigid body rotates, they can move. What is there? So how it is possible? If you have not seen, doesn't mean that it will not occur. Moment of, you type in YouTube, moment of gears between belts, you see numerous diagrams. Let's come to the concept. So in circular motion, go back here. If you rotate any plate, you take velocity of this plate point and the velocity of this point. Agreed? What is linear velocity? The plate is rotating, let's assume. This is a center of plate. Nothing to do with problem. I'm just trying to develop the concept. What point all these points are rotating? About the center. Then for that, what you can do? draw a velocity, draw a line joining the edge of the velocity vectors. And draw another line joining the we'll take this one, joining the tail of velocity vectors where they intersect, where both the lines will intersect. That will be the center of rotation. About that point, in fact, they are rotating. Sir, how do I come to know? This is what I told you. You do rotate. I think every day you take food, lunch, breakfast, dinner. Plate will be there, no? Circular plate. Rotate it. Do some marking and try to see. Sir, but I don't know V1, V2. You do. Just take marker pen, draw that and try to rotate, no? Where they intersect, that will be the instantaneous center. So now similar method I'll apply it. Then, sir, what about this particular thing? I'll take for next problem also. I'll cover here only the concept. Oh, yeah, just wait. I'll get back the screen. Okay, now for next one, what we do is, I will go for another point here now. The point one, point two, point three. You extend this again. I think the idea is same. One and two are on same direction, same velocity. So now look at the two and three, they're in opposite direction. Then also what you should do, draw a line joining the edge of the velocity vectors and draw another line joining the tail of velocity vectors where the two lines will intersect. That is the instantaneous center. So what, instead of calling C, I'll call instant center. Now, sir, here also you wrote C, that is the center. So here, let me call this as instantaneous center. Okay, let's proceed here now. What shall I do? Now 2V and V, no? So this having 2V means I'll make it little bit vector like this. So what is the method now? First, the tail of velocity vectors. So from here, I'll draw a line. In the diagram only, I'll show it because I don't have again. Then what I should do, I should draw a line joining the edge of velocity vectors. Oh, it's going far away. Huh? Let us come for this one. So is it okay now? This is the instantaneous center. About this point, they are rotating. So what is this? We don't know this. We'll call Y. Now tell me, like, if you stand at point P, what you say? Everything is rotating about this instance with angle of omega. And we don't know this. So how to calculate? Let's see. What is V equal to? Y omega. Then what is this 2V is equal to? Somebody please mute it. Yeah. Now, what is 2V? What is the linear velocity of this point? 2V. And what is the distance? The radius is how much it is? The diameter 2R. So 2V is equal to 2R plus Y into omega. Let me equate these two. I'll divide these two. 2 by 2R plus Y by Y. So 2Y is equal to 2R plus Y. So therefore, what is Y is equal to 2R. So where the instantaneous center of this system is below the rigid body. Somewhere here, there's the instantaneous center. About this point, it's rotating. So now how to calculate omega? Yes, we know Y. So what is omega now? Can we calculate omega? yes, we can calculate omega. Please try to understand. It's a very simple idea, this one. Nothing is there. No concept, nothing. Just information. So now I'll substitute this y there. So what is v is equal to? We know v equal to y omega. And then what is y equal to r? So what is omega now? V by 2r. Now, sir, you tell me one thing, sir. Like, what is this omega? The angle of t with which all points on the rigid body will rotate about instantaneous center. But omega not given. I'm asking you to find out. That is what I asked you to find out here. If you know omega, then you can tell anything. So I want the velocity of point P. Tell me, what shall I do now? I know instantaneous center. It's quite very easy, no? What is the velocity of center of mass? I know instantaneous center and also the angular velocity. Let me get into the problem, the main problem. So I located instantaneous center. Let me bring it here. So this was the rigid body. What was the color? Color, blue color. And this was the rigid body, and let's talk about only the rigid body, that one. Just wait, please don't ask anything. Just wait, and I'll clarify everything. And now, so where is the instantaneous center? It was somewhere below here. This is how much distance. Now, what is the velocity of center of mass, BC? What is the velocity of this point? It should be, how to calculate that? How to calculate that one? So what I do, I'll draw a radius vector. And we know this is R, and we know this is R, and what is this distance? So what is the angular velocity with which it will rotate? It will rotate with omega. So can we calculate VP? How the direction of VP, the velocity of this point will be in this direction. How to calculate VP? For that we need smaller. What is smaller is equal to root of y square plus r square. 2r whole square plus r square. So this will be how much? R root 5. Then what is the speed of that point P? R into omega. What is r? R root 5. What is omega? We don't know omega. I think we have calculated, no? What was omega equal to? V by 2r. I'm just continuing the previous problem. So that will become V by 2r. So substitute that here, no? What is the speed of that particular point? So this will be root 5 V by 2.
Sir, shouldn't it be y plus r whole square, sir?
What is root?
Y plus r whole square plus r square, sir.
Oh, y plus r, no? Yeah. This is... Yeah, no, I think I'll make changes here. This will be y plus r whole square plus whole square. What I took... Oh, that one, no? Yeah. So this will become total 3r root 10. Check once calculation, ma. 9 plus 1, 10 root 10. Yeah. Root 10 by 2. Okay, check once calculation, and then I'll proceed it. R get cancelled. Okay, this is the velocity. What is the velocity of center of mass? Y plus R into omega. So this will be 2R plus R. Omega is V by 2R. So this will be 3V by 2. I can find out velocity of any point, no? So, but we don't know omega. This is, I brought it. Now, what is the kinetic energy of this one? So what is, it is having both translatory as well as rotatory. This is the one best conclusion is what I'm making. Please, all of you, try to understand. There's a belt, no? the omega which I was showing about ancient center, the same omega now I'll show about center of mass. The omega I'm showing. So now what happened? You should question, sir, what is this? In one diagram you are showing omega there, another diagram you are showing omega somewhere, and we should you are saying that don't ask question, just okay, listen, understand. Is your teacher right or your teacher mad? Sometimes showing omega, sometimes omega here. Yes, both are correct. No, who will see this diagram? Person on the ground. Who will see this diagram? Person at instantaneous center. When you look at that ancient center, you see all points are rotating about ancient. The total rigid body is rotating about ancient center. When you are at ground, what you come in, all points are rotating about center of mass and center of mass is moving. But we don't know omega. That is what unknown thing I calculated. Just if you know the velocity of upper and lower belt, what you can calculate? You can calculate the everything or entire thing about the problem. Now tell me, what is the total kinetic energy? Translational plus rotational. What is the translational kinetic energy? MVC square. What is the rotational kinetic energy? IC omega square. You know VC and omega, substitute together, total kinetic energy of the rigid body. What is K? Total kinetic energy of cylinder. Or what it says, cylinder, no? What we took? Some cylinder, solid cylinder. Are you able to understand? There's a very
IC is about the point of about this point, sir.
IC M R square by 2. No, you want only rotational kinetic energy. What you should write? Moment of inertia. I think the symbols. This is instantaneous center. Okay, ma. I think that capital IC, small IC. IC is moment of inertia. MI about center of mass of cylinder. Center of mass C of cylinder. Okay, fine. Now I think I'm not confusing you. This omega. This is what I'll do one thing. The same color I'll give it so that the confusion will get eliminated forever. So just if you know the velocity of belt, S means if you just know velocity of any two points in a rigid body, you can do anything with the rigid body. That one. I'll give one more similar condition. And now, if the velocity of the, you can do it. You can take that rotational motion about any point. And this is 2V. Similar, similar condition. So let me take this a disk now. Radius r, mass m. So what is the velocity of the upper and lower belt? Two v and v. So I want first in center, then the velocity of point P. Anything, or let me take this side. I want the velocity of point P, velocity of center of mass. Find VC, VP, and kinetic energy of the disk. So, shall we call this the upper belt? This is the lower belt. Okay, now. So, what shall you do? So, what is the basic concept? Draw a velocity vector, draw a line joining the head of velocity vector, draw a line joining the tail of velocity vector, where they intersect, that is the instant center. So from sir, how you can think like that? I just took the rigid body, some disk, rotating, not only disk, any rigid body, then what I noticed is this particular thing, it is rotating about its center, I know. Then when I look at the geometry, I got that condition. So this condition is what I'm applying here. I'm not bringing new thing. The rotation of rigid body, you might have noticed this. Of course, we don't notice. That's why we are stressing it separately. Actually, if you have noticed, there's no need to discuss this topic. See, that's what science is all about, observation. Yes, belt seems to rotate means at that instant, the velocity of belt will be there like that only. Okay, come for this one. So what is the basic thing? This is 2V. So where is the center of mass? Center of mass is here, no? Exactly at the midpoint. This is R, this is R. Now what shall I do? I'm going to draw a line joining the velocity vectors. This is the velocity vector 2V and this is V. So this is the center C, and this is the instantaneous center about which they are going to rotate. High C, I should write, and this is the omega. So what is the distance now? So let me call this is Y. Now then, what is the equation? 2V is equal to R plus Y into omega. Then what is V? V should be equal to R minus Y omega. So this distance will become R minus Y. Divide these two. So 2 is equal to R plus Y by R minus Y. So 2R minus 2Y is equal to R plus Y. Y, shall I write R by 3? Where the incident center will be below the center of mass. So incident center must be on the rigid body. Need not know, it can lie on the rigid body, it can lie outside the rigid body. We don't know omega, so I'll substitute value of y, I'll get the omega. But what we know only velocity of upper and lower belts. So how to bring the omega? I'll take help of any one equation. V equal to R minus Y into omega. What is Y? R by 3. Omega equal to 3V by 2R. S. This is the angular velocity with which the rigid body is rotating. Okay, but we wanted velocity of what? Point P, all other things. I'll push it this one here. Okay, now you got omega. After getting omega, now I want the velocity of point P. Where our incident center is? Incident center is somewhere here, no? I'll put star mark. Not center of mass. There's the instantaneous center. Then can we calculate the velocity of point P? Yes, we know all the information. Here, this is R. So what is the velocity of point P? How to locate? It will be like this. What is the velocity of center of mass? Will be like this. This is the instantaneous center. Don't use any other symbol. IC only we have to write it. And this is that Y. So this is R. So how to calculate that? What is small r should be equal to? Small r should be equal to root of R square plus Y square. What is Y equal to? R by 3 whole square. So this should be equal to R by 3 root 10. So now what is the speed of point P? Which is equal to how much? R into omega. What is small r? R by 3 root 10. What is omega? 3V by 2R. root 10 by 2 into V. Okay, this is the speed of that point P. Now I want a velocity of center of mass. I don't know. That what you can write it as? Y into omega. What is Y is equal to? R by 3. Omega is 3V by 2R. This is the speed of the center of mass. Then can we calculate total kinetic energy? Translational plus rotational. What is the translational kinetic energy? Mass of the disk into velocity of center of mass plus moment of inertia. So if you are getting confusion, I'll write high O. What is O? O is the center of mass. Some of you are getting confusion. I'll write O. I think it's substitute, you'll get it. So just if they give velocity of any two points on a rigid body, can you predict the angular velocity? Yes. And now, sir, like a practically about what point the disk is rotating? What is this K? Kinetic energy of the disk. No. Practically about omega. Omega will be about O only. The diagram, what we see practical will be of this kind. Center of mass will be moving. Omega naught. So if you just know these two quantities, this velocity of the upper and lower belt, you can predict all other things. Velocity of center of mass, angular velocity. But sir, like you wrote omega about instant center. Then again, you are writing about O. I think if you stand at instant center, you feel all points are rotating about instant center. You stand on the ground, you feel all points are rotating about center of mass and center of mass moving towards right. So who is drawing this diagram? Who is drawing this diagram? Person on the ground. So getting the overall picture. So tomorrow what happened? we'll explore few more problems. They just get this one. We'll see this particular motion with respect to rod, cone, different types of rigid body. We took only rolling bodies. We'll take the different rigid shape of rigid bodies, how we can apply this condition. Got the idea? Okay. Thank you for your patience and attending, showing interest in class. Tomorrow we'll continue further. Okay. Thank all of you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.